Hello students, welcome to BTech first year bridge course. In this course, I will discuss module 4, which includes electrostatics and magnetostatics. Now, when we talk about electrostatics, it actually the study of effect of stationary charges or stationary charge distributions. Now, stationary charge means the charge which is not moving. And the effect means production of electric field and electric potential of that charge. So, the study of electric field and electric potential of stationary charge is done in electrostatics. And for that purpose, here we will start with electrostatic Gauss's law. So, this law was introduced by Carl Friedrich Gauss, who was a contemporary physicist of Charles Coulomb. And you know, Charles Coulomb is renowned for Coulomb's law in electrostatics, which quantifies the electrostatic force between point charges, that you know. But the limitation of Coulomb's law lies here. So, it finds the magnitude of electric field due to point charges only, right? So, here at P point, the resultant electric field due to this system of point charges can be written like this, and it is based on the principle of superposition. Now, for charge distribution of arbitrary shape, if we want to find out the electric field, we have to apply this equation as we are dealing with continuous charge distribution. Right, and the summation over all these terms is written like this integration. This you know from the concept of calculus that you have studied in your 12th class, right? Now here this rho is the volume charge density, as it is a volume charge distribution, right? So there can be planar charge distribution or linear charge distribution also. Now, to find out the electric field, we have to know the form of this rho, right, charge density. And the shape of the charge distribution, we have to know. Now, if this charge distribution is very much non-uniform, then this integration is very difficult to solve. And electric field cannot be found out easily. So, that is the point where Gauss's law helps us to find out electric field more easily, right? So, to understand this, let us draw two pictures, and here you can see an arbitrary closed surface S is constructed. So, these are discrete point charges where we are considering a arbitrary closed surface is enclosing these discrete charges, and here the closed surface is enclosing this continuous charge distribution. And these are the resultant electric field lines which are coming out from these charges. So, for the time being, we are considering these are positive charges, right? Now, if you have negative charges, then in that case, electric field lines will converge on the negative charge, that you know. And this surface is called the Gaussian surface. Now, let's find out the electric flux through this closed surface, okay? You know that electric flux is quantified as number of electric field lines passing perpendicularly through an arbitrary surface area. And interestingly, if we found out the total flux for this configuration, okay? The amount is total charge enclosed by the surface divided by the permittivity of the region. So, as here the system is in free space, this is free space permittivity. Okay. Similarly, for continuous charge distribution, the form is like this. So, what we understand that electric flux through a closed surface is proportional to the charge enclosed by the surface, right? So this is the essence of Gauss's law. Here we are considering a surface which is enclosing this positive charge, and electric flux is finite and positive here because the field lines are diverging out from this positive charge. Now if you have a negative charge, the flux will be negative because the field lines convert at the negative charge. But here the total resultant flux is zero because the field lines which are going through this portion of the surface, those are coming out from this outer portion of the surface. Okay, so resultant flux becomes zero here, right? So we have obtained the total flux through the Gaussian surface due to this enclosed charge, and this is the form of the flux, right? So here this Q is actually the Q enclosed, means the charge enclosed by the Gaussian surface, right? So this is called the integral form of Gauss's law, and we have to remember this that the charge here is enclosed by the Gaussian surface, right? If the charge is not enclosed by the Gaussian surface, in that case the flux will be zero, that we have seen. So this is very important, the charge has to be enclosed by the Gaussian surface, right? Now the Gauss's, if we apply the Gauss's divergence theorem, what is Gauss's divergence theorem? It tells that the total volume integration of divergence of any vector field is the total flux of the vector field over any closed surface. Okay, so this is the Gauss's divergence theorem. And as here we are considering this is a volume charge distribution, in that case we can write this charge, total charge Q is basically volume integration rho dV, right, where rho is the volume charge density, right? So using this divergence theorem and this fact, we can write down this equation, right? And for finite volume, the integrand has to be zero, right? Integrand means here, if we take this right side term, at the left side, this becomes del dot E minus rho by epsilon naught in bracket, then dV. So as we are considering this is a finite volume, the integrand is del dot E minus rho by epsilon naught, that has to be zero because right side is zero. So that's why it becomes del dot E equal to rho by epsilon naught. Okay, so this is actually the differential form of Gauss's law. Now these two forms, this integral form and these differential forms, helps us a lot to find out the electric field very easily. Okay, now the differential form of Gauss's law has different forms in different coordinate systems. Now you know what is coordinate system already. So in Cartesian coordinate, the form of the divergence of electric field is like this. In spherical polar coordinate, the form will be like this, because here the components are r theta phi, here components are xyz, and you know that from Cartesian coordinate to spherical coordinate we can transform, right? There are transformation equation from one coordinate to other, that you know. In cylindrical coordinate the form will be like this. Okay, now if we know the charge density by solving this type of partial differential equation, one can find the electric field. Also, the electric field can be found out from this integral form, right? Now, you know this form is always true. It is valid for any type of arbitrary shape of the Gaussian surface. But if that is the case, then Gauss's law is not useful, right? When it will not be useful? If the charge density is not uniform, okay? And also the Gaussian surface is arbitrary in shape. Because in cases with symmetry in charge distribution and Gaussian surface, the electric field is in same direction of normal on the surface. So if we are considering a very symmetric Gaussian surface or symmetric charge distribution, so one symmetry is spherical symmetry that I will discuss in the next slide. So in that case, the direction of the electric field and direction of the normal on the surface will be at the same direction. And also it is constant in magnitude over the surface. So without this, we cannot pull out this electric field value, electric field out of this integral, right? So let's discuss different symmetries and how Gaussian surface are constructed, okay? So in spherical symmetry, we have to make our Gaussian surface concentric spheres, right? So here the charge distribution is very much symmetric, that is spherical symmetry is there. This is spherical in nature, charge distribution. So that's why you are considering symmetric Gaussian surface, spherically symmetric Gaussian surface. And in that case, this E is constant. So E at a particular distance, this electric field magnitude will be constant. So in that case, the electric field multiplied by the area of that surface area, right? Surface, Gaussian surface, that is 4 pi r square equal to Q enclosed by epsilon naught, and from there we can find out the electric field is Q enclosed by 4 pi epsilon naught r square at the outside point of the charge distribution, right? So this is the form of the electric field outside the spherical charge distribution. Now in cylindrical symmetry, we have to make Gaussian surface coaxial cylinders. So here this is the form of the electric field for long cylindrical charge distribution, which is shown over here, and we have to construct the coaxial Gaussian cylinders to find out the electric field at a particular distance r. And here this lambda is the charge per unit length. Now in planar symmetry, we have to use Gaussian pillbox. Now what is Gaussian pillbox? This is a typical picture of Gaussian pillbox. Now for infinitely extended charge plane, we can draw the Gaussian surface or Gaussian pillbox like this. Okay, so here this is the form of the electric field. Okay, so here this is the charge per unit area, and you can see the field is independent of the distance of the field point where we want to find out the electric field. So today I am concluding here. In the next class, we will find the divergence of electric field, that is del dot E, okay, directly using the form of the divergence. So we have proved the form of the differential form of Gauss's law from integral form. Now we want to find out the divergence of electric field directly, okay. So that we will discuss in the next class. Thank you.